I'm Adi Bolboaca. I will do some live coding in three different languages. I will show you how I do refactoring and some heuristics, some techniques I learned that help me have flow in the refactoring process. So this is me. I am programmer. I also do trainings. I do coaching. While doing some refactoring workshops and some preparing for these, I found out that, in fact, I'm doing things in a certain way. And I'd like to talk with you and not only just show you, I'd like to have a conversation with you on these ideas. I also wrote a book about Code Retreat, which is a one-day practice event that I know some of you attended, and it's a one-day event of practice, learning, pair programming, getting out of the comfort zone. This is about how to facilitate and how to host one. I am interested in subjects that, in a way, raise the bar. So this is why the subject I'm interested now is evolutionary design. And I think evolutionary design happens while refactoring. So how, in fact? How could we understand, how could we evolve the design in a natural way? And these are some ideas that I found with refactoring heuristics. Now, I've observed this thing and discussing with many people who do have done TDD for a longer period than I have. And we have two ways of solving a problem. We either have like the school way, we have analysis, okay, we start doing some designs and then we go on and we have the solution, okay, and we implement the solution. So this is focused on solution then. We focus on solving that specific solution and we believe it's the one, and it's the best, or it's the only one we know. And the other idea is when we focus on the problem. And when you focus on the problem, basically what you do is you divide the big problem into small chunks of small problems, and for each one of them you find small solutions, and then you aggregate them. And aggregating them means refactoring, in fact. And this means how evolved design. I wrote here a bit of rant about how this happens. For me, waterfall means that you just create the solution, you implement it with no feedback loop. Then if you do just planned and iterative without feedback from the end, then it's misunderstood agile. Then you also have the feedback at the end, or if you look at the code, if you look at the tests, if you look at any type of feedback loops that exist there, then of course you also can solve like that, have a iterative approach on a solution with an agile approach. But when you focus on the problem, I think this is in fact what extreme programming means. And extreme programming, in fact, says we want to write the smallest code possible, solve your problem, and then we'll see what will happen, okay? So this is why I said it's unplanned. It's unplanned because you don't have really a big plan ahead. It doesn't mean that unplanned doesn't mean that I don't have anything. It just means I want to focus now on solving the problem now. But if you do the same thing, if you just do iterations without feedback, it's not really extreme programming. It's something that's missing. So if you do this, in my view, if you focus on the problem all over, you do it iterative, you have this iterative approach, in fact, you have evolutionary design. So this is basically what means code evolution focused on the solution, right? This is, I think, what I don't know, I've done that. I don't know if you've done that. Many people have done this kind of approach. We have the big problem. We make an analysis, do the architecture, some then do the design, and then some people write the code and will say that the architecture is bad. Right, and then the design is bad. So, but we cannot change it because they gave it to us and it's in the documentation and the customer agreed on that. So that's what happens. But yeah, anyway, at the end, sometimes you also measure the efficiency and make some hacks or changes. The other thing is when you focus on the problem, and this is what I will try to show you, at least in that period, to try to see how we can refactor effectively, what heuristics we can see. So this is what I'm doing typically. I do some analysis. I want to understand the problem, but then I try to find the simplest solution possible, and I implement that smart thing. I start with the test, okay, and then you complicate the solution. So I will use a technique that maybe some of you heard about. It's called TDD as if you meant it, for showing that kind of thing. It's kind of a weird approach, very classicist, extreme classicist TDD approach, focused on state tests. Also here, I learned from my fellow testers that it's a big difference between checking testing. So basically, testers say that automating testing doesn't have any sense, because testing means a human being will use their ability to understand the system and maybe to find possible entries, possible problems. Once you find that, you can automate it, and that's a check. So, in fact, that's why I said check, test, and deploy, because checks can be automated. They're just inputs and outputs. You put them in a test, and then you increase your test coverage. But testing needs to be done as well. So that's why I really believe we need development tester, like me testing the application after I wrote it. And we need testers after that as well to validate other things. So exploratory testing. Refactoring. I think it's the essential part of evolutionary design. And for me, evolutionary design doesn't mean only TDD, adding new code. It also means when we do things, I do quite often refactoring legacy code. So you evolve as well the design. You can evolve it in an evolutionary way by looking at certain things. And refactoring means changing the structure of the code without changing the behavior. And that's essential when you do legacy refactoring. So here what you do is you want to generate a design that is specific to a certain problem. This is why you focus on the problem. And it's very interesting how we do that. We navigate through possible solutions. How do we know the solutions? Well, we don't. But we can observe things. How we observe things? Well, through experience, through practice. And these are heuristics I want to talk about. There are things people with a lot of experience with refactoring see. And then when I go to a company and do a refactoring workshop, I ask them, do you see something here? Often it's like, no. So for me, it was clear that something's missing there. And something comes from practice. It's like an eye. It's like something of a smell you develop just because you practiced. And I have a theory in the end, very interesting theory, that maybe will help us understand that. As a prerequisite, we need to learn things, like theory. I said here laws, design concepts and laws, but they're not really laws, right? We can break them. It's more like guidelines. And then if you know these concepts, you can observe where they are violated. If you don't know them, it's very difficult, right? So first of all, I think if we want to be good designers, we need to learn a lot, to discuss a lot, to read a lot about these things. And then practice with them in mind and also, you know, try to exercise the brain. So that's practice. Now, refactorings, what's in the book Refactoring, are just like, you know, some clearly defined steps in order to go there. Like, what is what does rename mean? How do you do rename? In the IDE, you press the rename thing, right? But that's not, in fact, what you do. If you have, I don't know, if you're working on C code, your IDE probably doesn't do that. So there are very specific steps that are safe. And that is essential. That is refactoring. It's not just hacking around. Like, a rename means I create a new variable, then I want, with a new name, then I want to change the new variable to redirect it to the old one, and then I merge them together. There are specific steps if you read the book. And most often people believe that refactoring is just changing code. That's changing code, but refactoring means really clear steps. Now, the problem is that I see people don't use them in correct order. Correct order can be any order, as long as we have flow. If I have a blockage while refactoring, it means I don't know enough, either about the problem or the code space, or I don't have enough good smells. I don't know how to smell the code. And that's, for me, the refactoring heuristics. So some heuristics. I'll show code, I'll write code, I'll ask you to tell me what you think, to have a dialogue while doing that. For me, these are signs telling you when to use a refactoring. But for some of them, there exists some writing, but for others, it's not. There isn't a lot of. There aren't a lot of places you can learn from. But even like that, you can read about them. You still need to practice to see them everywhere. Like, I was pairing with a very experienced guy and in TDD, and we are looking at a big system, and like cruising around, looking at the code, not doing a lot. I said, look, this is duplicated with that one that we saw half an hour ago. How come? Let's see. And then doing some, I don't know, 3-4 refactorings would make the code identical. So that's a skill you have if you exercise it. And I think if we don't do that a lot, we won't be able to make our systems a lot easier to change. Okay. It's also useful to know which refactorings not to use at some moment. So I think this is one of the essential ideas to have us flow, to have a flow. Who knows this, like, refactoring mantra? Hands up. Who's doing that? Yeah? Not really. Okay. So this is what I'm doing typically. My cycle here is, how many minutes do you think? Yeah, so on average is around between 2 and 3 minutes. Here in this. But after 25 minutes, I prefer to take a break sometimes when I don't forget. And then you can push it to central repository if, well, you finished what you wanted to do. What do you do here? So you look at stuff like, are names good enough? And this is about clarity. You focus on clarity. Now, and then you look at structures. And structures mean, in fact, those design concepts, laws, guidelines. And they're complicated. Whenever I talk with people about low coupling, high cohesion, it's always difficult. It's so abstract. So maybe we can use some heuristics to understand that better. Also about responsibilities. Like I'm looking at the class and I say, how many responsibilities do you think that has? Answer 3. I said, it's 15. How 15? That's a lot. I mean, and then I explain them. I say, yeah, I didn't see those. So most often I see people don't really observe the number of responsibilities a class has. So I'm gonna get out of these slides, and I will show you a way I do this on a new code base. I will use C# for this. Do you know the LCD kata? No? It's a kata I found about a couple of weeks ago, and it's very interesting. So you have this LCD, so a display, and you'd like to give it a number, and it needs to display that number on the LCD. So, you know, this is like 1, 2, 3, how it should be displayed, right? Typically, you have like an 8. That's most of it, what you can display. And the kata is have input number, and then of any size, and then the display should show you. So let's see how I will do that. So using this set, the system already set up, I have here the runner, the test runner, and I have here a git as well. So let me add this. Okay, so now I will use TDD as if you meant it. Please stop this, ask me anytime. I'm just doing like that, using this kind of test to see that the everything works with the test framework. So this works now, so I can start really working with it. Now, considering that I have this LCD kata, what I want to do in doing this mantra, like I told you, focusing on the solution, not focusing on the solution, but on the problem, what you do is you simplify everything. So you can have several levels that, and you can simplify more things. Like, what would be the simplest possible test to write here for the LCD kata? I have a number, any size, and then it should display on this display. The 8. For 0 size, okay, so you're saying 8, 0 size. Any other ideas? Sorry? Which number? Yeah, but I'd like to come with examples. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Okay. That's a bit too much for me. A bit too big. The test is too big. it's a good acceptance test, but it's too much for the beginning, at least for me. Weird enough, what I think it's simpler from in this case is the space. Well, let's consider that I have like a display size of 2, and I have a number that is just of 1 digit. And if I'd have this situation, I would be able to have a space in the beginning. And I think that's the most the simplest test I can write. So let me go back to TDD as if you meant it. We have some rules here. The rule is that I'm not allowed to create new classes and methods. All the production code will be generated from this test. So I need to write both the production and the test in this test method, which can be weird. So bear with me a bit. I write the first test like in the TDD way, red, green, refactor. So here I have some expected output. And the expected is something like space, and then a space, and then a 1, right? But I didn't implement anything. So the actual is nothing, or empty string. What I do now is I want to extract here. Oh no, what are you doing? I think I hit something wrong. I opened a new one, no problem. I want to extract this, and I always forget because they want to mess up with. Yeah, but I don't know why my shortcuts that don't work. New laptop, new problems. Oh, it's Control Shift R. Yeah. Yeah, so I'll do just Control Shift R. So then what I want to do is I introduce this variable. And this is like the expected, right? And this is the. Yeah, it doesn't work, so I'll do just that. This is the actual. Now, this is what I do with TDD as if you meant it. And now I need to add the context, right? And the context is that I have an input, number, which is 1. And I have a and now I'd like to see, to really implement this in the actual part. So how does this look like? So I could say something like, if the input number is 1, then I would have something like space 1. Oop. And else, I don't know, something like that. And this test should have the name something like 1 space is shown, is displayed when showing 1 digit number on 2 digit display. Okay. Now, what you do in classical TDD approach is you triangulate. So triangulation means that you want to focus on understanding better your problem space. And una pausa. Mm-hmm. So we have 5 minutes to the first break. So you want to triangulate and to see, to go to the problem space. And my problem space is now, in fact, I want to see how I could extract a function out of this production code. So if you go to what a test is like that, right? Arrange, act, assert. Arrange just sets up my system. Act means that I get information from my production code. I act on the system under test. And then assert means that I do the check. So now what I do with the mantra I told you, now I just do a commit. Because I'm on green. So first test, green. I don't have enough data to be able to extract anything now. So with 3D of Humanity, you want to generate duplication in order to remove it. So I want to create a new test. And I want to triangulate on this idea with space, because I want to see where I go. So how? What could be like the next test? I want to triangulate on space, not on one. That won't help me, because I won't have a space in the production code. I do want to have a space in production code so I'd be able to have more duplication to understand how to structure the code while removing it. Yes, that's what I'd like to have. So I'd like to have something like space, space, one. And again, what I do is I do this. I introduce the variable, and this is expected. Oh, come on. And I want to introduce this variable, which is actual. Now, the same idea, how do I implement this? So I need to have an input number, which is again one. But then I also need the display size. And here it's three, right? So I missed it here. I do need the display size. Here it was two. You didn't tell me. Sorry? Yeah, but here, I said something that I didn't have. So you shouldn't do that, ever. You either change the name of the test or you change the test. So when you do this, basically, you'd like to generate a kind of a, in the range, you'd like to generate a display, like an initial display. So I probably would need something like string display is something like if, no, it's something like display size. It's an if as well, but so if it's two, then I will, oops, then I will create something like space, space, because initially the display is just empty. Otherwise, it's just like that. Otherwise, it's just like that. So then, what is this? In fact, all this function means that I change the display. So I would need to extract this. Yes, I would need to extract this. Yes, thank you. To a display. To a display. Variable. Okay. So I'm in the arrange part, I'm generating, like I'm setting up my display, I'm starting it, then I have, I explain what's the expected, then I change it. So here I can do be the same, right? So I do have a display, and the display, of course, is again depending on display size. So if display size is 3, then it should be something like space. Otherwise, it should be just empty string. So now, if I run this, it's only the new test that's not passing, so it's good. I'm on red. Now let's make it green in the most simple way, as in TDD. What you do is you try to really say something like display equals. So if I have the input number 1, then I would have something like space 1. Otherwise, I will have just space. And then the actual should be the display. Okay. Oops. Using too much IntelliJ. Shift F10. Now, if I run this screen, again, I want to give it a name. So what's the good name for this? Yeah. So I said something like one space is displayed, so it's two spaces are displayed. When showing one digit number on 3 digits display. So now I have this, it's green, I can commit again. Added second test. If I look at this code now, I just want you to see both of them. I don't have a very big screen because of the resolution. If you look at them, you start seeing duplication. And that's what you want to have to see most often when you do this type when you have this type of approach. What is the duplication you see in these two tests? I think they're around like at least 5-6 concepts. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's true. So I have a comparison. That's a transformation I make there in a way. What else? Okay. So the setup is almost the same. Almost the same. So it's just this thing that's different. So how could I make this to look like? This is what I want to do in this moment. Yeah. Yes. Yes, exactly. So if you do this, you understand that you have a concept that means separator and a concept that means like space. So I have space everywhere here. Oops. Okay. So if I do this in all the tests, I will start seeing it a lot better. Because I think this is the most visual type of and most the clearer in a way type of deprecation I have now. It's everywhere. Okay, and here as well. Because yeah, this is a concept in fact, and I am doing primitive obsession by choice because I didn't want to spend a lot of time on drawing pipes and lines and so on, because I have this idea that I don't care about representation when doing this kind of, when having this kind of approach. What I care more is about the concept that I want to describe. So if I write like that space with text, or if I write like an array with 8 empty somethings, it's the same thing. I don't care about how I represent it. So now if I have a smart ID, if I say something like extract method, get space, I don't have a smart ID. So what you should have told me was, I see another 15 other places with the space. Do you want to replace them all? So that's where the ID helps you. I think this version of ReSharper is a bit older, and that's why it doesn't do that. If you use IntelliJ, if you use JetBrains, if you use the PHP Storm or RubyMine, this will work. Okay. And so if I do that, in a way I start abstracting. There's a break. Do you want to stop? The session will continue as always also after the break. If you want to stop, we can stop for a while, or you can go somewhere else as you wish. 5 minutes break. Okay, so now the tests run. I have another type of duplication. So I have this thing, this dash, and I could do the same because it repeats. Now, here what I use is another heuristic I will tell you a bit about later. It's called the rule of three. So the rule of three says, only extract things if you see them duplicated at least 3 times. And it's an heuristic, it's an idea, okay? It's not a rule, it's not a law, but it helps you. Because so often it can happen that if you just see it a couple of times, you extract it, and then you in fact introduce a wrong abstraction, just because that abstraction is, in fact, those two abstractions were different. So if you see it duplicated many times, it probably makes sense to do that. So I could do the same here and do extract method, get separator, and do the same here, and so on. So I have many places where I have this separator. Now, as you can see, the code becomes more and more detached by its structure, by its representation. And this is what I wanted. Because as I said, I wouldn't care if you have this representation in like this in text or a number, or I don't really care. What I want to do is generalize the way this test looks like. So I am running again the tests after I extracted this, and I have also this, and I'll rename it. I extract it again. I don't give the best name here. Typically, I just use a name and then we'll see. So I just say get one. So I'm moving on from this obsession of using only strings, and the code starts looking and like it should. I do have the abstractions popping up. Now, if I would write another test, I won't do that. But if I would write another test, you probably would say here, like, get space separated, so on, four times. And that means triangulation. That is a very important idea from classicist TDD that people don't use that much. Triangulation means that write at least three tests on a concept and make sure that you have like this object, this concept covered from more areas. And it comes from how you detect in 3D space an object, right? Because you need at least three coordinates. The more coordinates you have, the better. The same here. Like if I don't see duplication after a while I triangulate, it probably means I either don't have the good concept, I didn't write the good tests, but it's clearly not the moment to extract that concept. So, well, this is the mantra I'm using, like that, with TDD as if you meant it. It can be weird, but it's like, I do that, and now probably I'll write the next test and so on. It's quite fast if you do that all over. And it generates flow. And one thing I learned is that if you don't know what to do next, write a test. Wait 15 seconds and write the next test. Don't do anything else. So I'll stop here with this idea, with the refactoring mantra. Do you have any questions up to now? Well, in a way, yeah. I think this applies with TDD, applies with refactoring legacy code, applies with changing any code. So it's not only from, yes, it is from TDD, but I added this part that I very often do, the committing part, which doesn't exist in the red-green refactor. And red-green refactor means only writing tests. I sometimes execute some tests on legacy code. If we had like another 3 hours, I would show you that on legacy code as well. Now, this is the rule of three. We extracted these ideas, these concepts, only when we have them three times. So whenever I see a design element repeat itself at least three times, it might be a sign of duplication. If it's not sure, write a new test, generate more duplication. So here, in fact, what you want to do is create duplication in order to remove it. The more duplication you see, the more obvious it is that you need to extract that concept. And this is a heuristic that you can use. I've done this. I've made the duplication identical. How? Because I had those strings, space, one, space, something. I, in a way, detached them. And at that moment, having those strings identical, I saw that they are identical. I want to show you some other code where I could do that. I have this. I have some Java code on the same LCD cut. I went further away. And so this is how it could look like, but it's in Java. And at one moment, I didn't know exactly how to go on. And I wrote more tests, okay? And I have this function, display number, which does something for some tests. And then I have another function. So if I move it to the top, another function, display number, that does something else. Now, do I have here a duplication? Am I ready to remove it? So I wanted to use that idea of make duplication identical. Now I wouldn't extract anything, although there are some things here that are almost, there are identical, like the first line here, with the first line there. But we're not there yet. So what I can do, I can write more tests and triangulate more, start having more functions like this, display number, or I could try to make these ones identical. What are your thoughts? How could we do that? Any ideas? Another hint here. Another heuristic. This type of In this transformation, let's say, I always use a get one as an internal return value. So get one is here. It's here. Here I have an if. Here I have a loop. Have you heard about the transformation priority premise that Robert Martin wrote? So he says that we do transformation in a certain order. And if we look at these concepts in that order of transforming from very simple, like from null, then to a variable, to a constant, then to a variable, and so on, then you can see that you generalize the things. And this is what he's saying. So we could we have these transformations, and ideally we shouldn't skip them. We have from nothing to nil. This is the first one. From nil to constant. Constant to constant in another layer of abstraction. Constant to scalar. Statement to more statements, unconditional to if, and somewhere here says if to while. So let's look again at the code. What do I have here? Here I have an if. Here I have a loop. So this is a higher order transformation than this. In a way, this is a generalization of this code. So I could write a for here, and the code would be identical. Mm-hmm. Well, I think if I write a 4, it's enough because I'll just return get 1. So I'll get rid of that anyway. So these are like the laws I was telling you, the concepts and laws that help us see these duplication, see these, or try to make this duplication simpler. If I look at this code now, let's see. No, it cannot help me. So let's see. I'm running the tests, first of all. Something's not working. Yeah, I think I forgot to ignore this. So it's always good to... it's always good to run the tests before. This is just I was evolving it, and so it's not a finished test. I'll just ignore it. So going back here, if I would change this to 4, int I equals to 0, I smaller than display parts at length, I plus plus. What do I do here? Display parts of I equals get 1. What did I miss? Oh, So I don't need this, I think. Let's see. So the test run, right? I just changed this from a conditional to a 4. So I raised the level of abstraction. And now I clearly see that these two are identical. Now, these are the types of things we need to exercise in order to see duplication in code. And this is a very simple example. I mean, if you have a huge function in a huge class, in a huge system, would you be able to see these kinds of masked duplications around the system and say, hey, we should extract a component because it's there and there and there and there. Yeah. No, that was extracted with TDD as if you meant it, so probably yes. Yeah, yeah. But that's why I have those tests to help me out. You are right. You need enough tests. With TDD, as you've mentioned, you always like create the test and then you extract the production code that's already tested inside it. So it's quite impossible not to have covered that. Of course, you could write... it's possible sometimes to miss some things as well. But in this case, this function was extracted just because I had three tests, and then it was duplicated in between the tests. I extracted it, and then it becomes a system under test. And yeah, it's a very good point to emphasize, have enough tests. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, yeah. But that's my hint here, and it's easy because I wrote the code, and it's a simple code base. It's, of course, this is why I looked at them, because they seem duplication, but then the idea was how could I make them identical so that I could merge them. So how is looking at transformation priority premise and generalizing the structure from conditional to loop. Yeah. So now these are almost identical. I only have this thing. Oops, this thing. And I need to understand what it is. But this is what I mean by making code identical. And I think we should practice a lot with this. Another heuristic I used is this. I don't know if you saw me, but I moved the method to be together, well together, right? So when you want to refactor, make sure that the code you believe it's similar or identical, you move it close. Because in this way, you'd be able to have a better idea on how to transform it. If you cannot move, like with a nicer IDE, don't cut and move. You always copy, paste it somewhere. Make sure you don't lose it in this process. Someone will complain about having identical methods, then delete the old one from the old place. Okay? If you have a good IDE, then just do that. So if I go back to how this looked. So I was, back. This code looked like that. So how easy would be for you to look at this? This is display number. This is display number here. Okay, I can close this to have more space. But still, I have this thing in the middle that is like annoying me. And this is okay, this is quite close anyway. But what if you have big chunks of code in very different parts of the system? What you want to do is put them together and look at them in a to see similarities. But what I do, I just move it on the top. It's a very simple and helpful thing. And I observed people don't do this often. So what they do is so let's say you have it like here, and they say, how is this like this? And then they say, is it similar to this? So keep scrolling up and down, and it's really confusing. It takes a lot of time. What's the time left? Sorry? 10 minutes, okay. I want to show you another one, small code width. I have this idea, this rule, that whenever I write code, I want to write it with an 18 font. And if I write with 18 font and it gets out, it's too wide, it means I wrote too much code, or the test name is too long. It's difficult to understand. So what you can do in this case, you could extract method, you could consolidate conditional or a logical expression. But this is like a thing I do in IDEs. I try to have a big, very big font. And let's see. I will take some, not this one. I'll take another code base in Java. And this is a trivia game. And if I look here, you see I have a big font. So I don't know exactly. If I look at settings, let's see. fonts. So it's 18, as I told you. I like to use 18. So if I'm like that, you can see that there are some places where it kind of gets out on the right. This means something's wrong. Something is wrong, and you know, here I have a problem with cyclomatic complexity. It's that easy to see. So what I could do in the first part, as the first refactoring at this moment, I could just focus on extracting this part of the code to a new method. And this is, I don't know, rolling the dice. And then you could use like the typical refactorings. You could start refactoring this as well, the body of each one. So you extract this, rolling even number. This is again too big, not rolling even number. And the code starts looking better. Like, I can read this function and I understand what it does. Well, if I extracted a good name, of course. Not in penalty box. Oh, look, IntelliJ is smarter. See, it tells me that I have already some code base that it's identical to this. Do you want to extract again? I won't at this moment. So look how this code looks now. It's a lot easier to read this than it was what was before. And now I can go back here and, okay, this is clearly way too wide. So what could I do here? I could do several places, as I said. I could extract this. So this means I could extract this to a variable, which means the fact that the player is outside of the 12 places in trivia. So I don't know. Get back initial place, and then. What I could do, I could extract this as well. So if it's wide, it's bad with a big font. Now I can start reading it without needing to scroll right and left. And it's a lot better, I think. Okay, these are some ideas. I have many more. We have 5 more minutes, so I'll close up. I'll just explain you about this adult parameter. I often see that you extract some functions, and then you see the same parameter all over. That's a duplication. It screams, I want to be a field of the class. It's, again, an heuristic. It's not always the case. I saw a few cases where it wasn't like that. But typically, it is like that. Yeah. Yeah. But what would you do? If you have, like, name, surname, email. Yeah, you can do that as well. But what if you have a class with a person always, giving it to a method even in a class? Yes. But still, you can use a constructor for that. That's why you have it. I agree, but what about stateful data structures? So here, I agree, I wouldn't like to have state in a class. But if you talk about data structures, like classes, classes that only store data, they don't have logic. Yeah, I don't have logic typically. I separate them quite well. So I use a constructor, and I make that a field. Okay. For me, that's a sign. If you have it in many, many methods of the same class, it is a sign of duplication. And it says, most often it says, I want to be a field. With classes that only have logic, you don't have this problem, or you shouldn't have this problem. Maybe with dependencies, other classes that interact and do dependency inversion. That could be also the case. So it's not about necessarily about data. It can be also about collaborators. So I have more of them like that. I plan to write more about that on my blog. If you want, we can discuss at the open space. And many more. I don't have all of them that well structured. And I told you I have, in the opening, I have this thing. I was tweeting and Sleepy Fox told me this very interesting idea that he said, the most more experienced I got with TDD, I thought that something akin Maguire et al. Is happening. So what is this? I don't know. So apparently, this is a study they made on taxi drivers in UK. And they said that there is a correlation in the amount of time spent as a taxi driver with the volume, the volume in posterior hypothalamus of how it is used. Basically, what they say is that the more a driver is experienced in finding a way, the faster or the easier he would navigate in a space. The hippocampus is used more. Because the hippocampus, in fact, is used for, apparently, for understanding how space is structured. So what Sleepy Fox is saying that these results show that if you do extensive practice, spatial navigation, you'll become better. For me, TDD and evolutionary design is, in fact, a navigation through possible spaces of the solution. So it's very, very interesting because, in fact, this is why if you practice more, you'll find the solutions faster because you see all the options easier. Like a cab driver would know, I have these 7 options. But the non-experienced driver would say, I'll take this one. And will adapt depending on the traffic and so on. So I want to share you with this, to leave you with this idea. Try to wire your brain by practicing more of this refactoring. If you want to be able to navigate through the solution, because this is what evolutionary design is. And this is what TDD really is about. Finding solutions while focusing on the problem. It's an interesting idea. I don't know if it's real or not, or if it has a connection or not. I don't have any proof on that. But it struck me with how I feel about this. So if you want to ever pair on that, contact me. I also am available for remote pairing. I do this from time to time. There's a contact form on my blog. And I think I have a couple of minutes or it's break time. So thank you very much.